He lost an ear.
I mean, I didn't have a dad. That's horrible, and it's, I wouldn't wish that upon anybody, but...
Hey, it's Tony Gonzalez with the latest rock news. An unexplained fire destroyed the Aberdeen Museum of History over the weekend. Within the museum was an entire section dedicated to Aberdeen native Kurt Cobain and the iconic career of Nirvana. Flames 15 to 20 feet high consumed the building as black smoke filled the interior, destroying the artwork and historic memorabilia inside.
Our favorite patient, display of patience, cause he's got a Puget Sound.
Stay tuned as we continue inside the Francis Beam Prophecies.
Welcome to the Word of Life podcast, where we discuss scripture based on scripture, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, feeding the lambs of Christ regardless of the traditions of our fathers and the precepts of man. I ask that you prayerfully consult the Holy Spirit to lead you into all truth. For those who have ears to hear, please let them hear. Hi everybody, thank you for tuning in. If you haven't watched the previous episode, I highly recommend you do, part one. What we're doing is covering the second verse of Frances Farmer Will Have Her Revenge on Seattle. If you are not familiar or caught up on this topic, I highly recommend looking in the description box below or on the website, wherever you may see the playlist to the according videos. We've been covering that Kurt Cobain was essentially a preliminary messenger from God. We're uncovering the conspiracy of his murder, and basically the album In Utero serves as a type of message for the last days, John the Baptist. And the song Frances Farmer Will Have Her Revenge on Seattle, as we've discussed in the previous episode, this is a prophecy about his daughter and her role in God's kingdom. We've already covered the first three lines in her false witness. Hope you're still with us to see if they float or drown. So in this episode, we're going to cover our favorite patient, a display of patience, disease-covered Puget Sound. Now, I will say right off the bat that Francis Bean would be a facet of who's considered in the Bible as the daughter of Zion or the daughter of the people. This is a huge topic, a very huge topic. It's almost endless. Mary Magdalene actually fits in this category. She would be a daughter of Zion or a daughter of the people. And though this is a huge, huge biblical topic, it's only a shadow of a deeper topic that we can find in the Nag Hammadi scriptures. The story of the daughter of Zion is really the story of the redemption of our souls. We could read about that in the Exorcise of the Soul. I'll leave that in the description box below if you want to go deeper into this. The book of Hosea is about the daughter of Zion. And pretty much the story is a daughter of God born into Satan's corruption and the story of her redemption, just like our souls have been born into Satan's corruption and will eventually become redeemed when we go into the Father's kingdom. So the Nag Hammadi scriptures reveal that revelation. But for this video, I'm only going to cover what is relevant to the lyrics of verse 2 and how it pertains to our Bibles and how we show it scripturally. So if you do a biblical topic search of the daughter of Zion, you could see it is just endless, endless. And you could do daughter of the people also, etc. But really, the story of the daughter of Zion, as you see on your screen, it just happens to be these two verses really cover her whole story. In her corruption, God will eventually, at least according to the Bible, will eventually afflict her. Not to punish her, but to bring her to redemption, to bring her to lament and sorrow over her whoredoms and all that kind of stuff. And eventually he will redeem her and marry her as her husband. And so you could see this right in the two verses. on your screen. I mean, this is the general story of redemption of the daughter of Zion. But what I want to focus on is that we see this in depth in the book of Malachi and the book of Zechariah. So what we're demonstrating here is simply the first line of the lyrics that we're covering. Our favorite patient, the daughter of Zion, was born into corruption. She is someone who is sick, who is in need of help, who is in need of healing, like many victims of sex abuse are. That's just like a mere example. So it's actually in this understanding that opens up the prophetic implications of the song Rape Me. So our favorite patient, and it's not just about sex abuse, it's just about, you know, being torn between two covenants, being a child of God and born into the kingdom of Satan and not knowing where to go and having to choose evil and good, and you're torn in between, as I tried to demonstrate in the intro of this video. So the daughter of Zion is our favorite patient. So we see this doctrine clear as day in Zechariah 2:7-10, that the daughter of Babylon really should be the daughter of Zion. So let's take a look. And of course, as shown on the previous slide, we should be comparing this with Malachi 2:11-16. I highly recommend you doing that on your own. Malachi 2:11-16, with Zechariah chapter 2 in full context. But for now, let's just look at verses 7-10. Deliver yourself, O Zion, that dwells with the daughter of Babylon. Now, Zion are God's people, okay? For thus says the Lord of hosts, after the glory he has sent unto the nations which spoiled you, for he that touches you touches the apple of his eye. Okay, apples in our Bible mean joy, okay? An apple is a symbol of joy. So When we're reading this, after the glory has he sent onto the nations which spoiled you, for he that touches you touches the apple of the eye, touches the apple of his eye. So the daughter is a joy of a father's sight, is the apple of a father's eye. It's the joy of a father's sight. So basically, he that touches the daughter of Zion will be cut off, as the book of Malachi says. And this doctrine, what it necessarily means is there will be a supernatural shift by the power in the hand of God, a paradigm shift, and the wicked will be clothed with death. Literally, they'll be losing their glory, as the book of Hosea says. They don't, you know, God is good to the righteous and the wicked, but the wicked aren't aware that, you know, their good looks and their money and all that kind of stuff, that looking like an everyday person is a gift from God that he gives gracefully. But as the book of Hosea says, that's going to change in God's time, because to bring people to repentance. So the wicked are going to be clothed with death. We actually see this prophetically in Nirvana's Heart-Shaped Box video. The video ends with Chris Novoselic in the shape of the cross. The curtain is the veil being opened. This is When the Lord comes in the brightness of his coming, the wicked will be clothed with death, because the serpent will have to bear the cross in the last days. We also see the corruption of the daughter of Zion throughout the video as well. Eventually, you know, like the book of Isaiah says, there's going to be seven women to one man. There's not going to be many men left. And, you know, the bottom line is, if you're raping and all that kind of stuff, you're going to be clothed with death. You're going to be rejected. So he that touches you touches the apple of his eye. You know, so they're going to lose their glory. They're going to lose their beauty. For the wisdom of Solomon says, and they shall hereafter be a vile carcass and a reproach among the dead forevermore. For he shall rend them and cast them headlong, that they shall be speechless, and he shall shake them from the foundation. And they shall be utterly laid waste and be in sorrow, and their memorial shall perish. Clearly, in verse 19, you could see the recompense of the death of a daughter, or the corruption or the destruction of a daughter. And it continues, and when they cast up the accounts of their sins, they shall come with fear, and their own iniquity shall convince them to their face. So, I mean, this just goes on and on. But really, when we compare this to Malachi 2, 11 through 16, we see this. And here's the kicker. Sing and rejoice, O daughter of Zion, for lo, I come, and I will dwell in the midst of thee, says the Lord. So within these verses, we could see that the daughter of Babylon really should be the daughter of Zion. Okay, so now let's take a look at Malachi 2, 11 through 16, because we see this in more detail. And there's some amazing stuff in here. There's amazing, deep doctrine going on in here. And, you know, let it be a warning to the sexually immoral. I'm serious, guys. If you're raping out there, God's truth is very offensive to the world. When the Father's kingdom eventually comes and everything becomes spiritual and all matter dissolves, if you're raping, you're not a man. You won't be worthy to have a penis. You won't be worthy to even have sex. And that lasts for eternity. And that sex is better. It's more enhanced. All that kind of stuff. You have to love your partner. You have to put your heart into it, not your brute sin nature into it. So it talks, and the male and female become one. This is what the scriptures talk about, and the hidden doctrine of the male and female becoming one. If you're raping your partner, you're going to feel that contention in your spirit. The book of Thomas the Contender says, their skin will devour openly, but in their spirits they will be persecuted secretly. I mean, it's just torment. And what Malachi 2 says, it says, it just leaves a very blunt warning. Do not deal treacherously with the wife of your youth. It doesn't say why. It just says don't do it. I mean, we know why, but so let's take a look at these verses. Judah hath dealt treacherously, and abomination is committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. For Judah hath profaned the holiness of the Lord, which he loved, and he married the daughter of a strange god. Okay? The Lord will cut off the man that does this. We covered this. That's the Hosea stuff. That's being clothed with death. You're cut off from the blessings of God that everybody has, even the righteous and the wicked. For the Lord will cut off the man that does this, the master and the scholar out of the tabernacles of Jacob, and him that offers an offering unto the Lord of hosts. And this have you done again, covering the altar with the Lord with tears, with weeping, with crying out, insomuch that you regard not the offering anymore, and receives it not at the will of your hand. That's the corruption of the daughter of Zion. Yet you say, wherefore? Because the Lord has been witness against you, and the wife of your youth, against him you have dealt treacherously. Yet is she thy companion, and the wife of thy covenant? All right. This gets into some really crazy stuff, okay? Biblical truth is very offensive to the world. Yet is she your companion and the wife of your covenant? This is literally converting over to a serpent. As we read in the book of Jeremiah, you can convert to be a serpent, become one of them. It's in the book of Jeremiah. So they take the daughter of Zion and they corrupt her soul, and even she actually becomes a serpent, that kind of stuff. This is what's in Malachi. We see it in the book of Jeremiah. So let's continue reading. Did not he make one, and yet the residue of the spirit, and wherefore one, that he might seek a godly seed? All right, this is the male and female becoming one, that if you're raping and sexually immoral, you're going to feel that contention that you have with your partner in your spirit. You know, this stuff is a mystery, but the Bible says don't do it. And if the Bible says don't do it, there's a serious reason not to do it. And, you know, this stuff lasts forever, apparently, or until they repent. Who knows? He that might seek a godly seed, therefore take heed of your spirit, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. For the Lord God of Israel, For the Lord, the God of Israel, says that he hates putting away. For one covers violence with his garment, says the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit that you not deal treacherously. You're going to feel that contention in your spirit. It's a very dreadful thing. Now, again, this topic is endless, but we could get the general gist of what this prophetically means, our favorite patient. So now, when we see in the lyrics a display of patience, this is an absolutely biblical concept. We've already seen in the previous video how Kurt was swayed and manipulated into rejecting Christianity, rejecting the Bible. So there's no way he could have wrapped his heart around these lyrics. He obviously had a sealed book of prophecy. We already established this. But in your patience, you possess your souls. God works with us slowly. Our repentance is slow. Our tribulations are slow because at the end we get stronger and we possess our souls. This life is a battle for the soul. The enemy is after our souls. And in our patience, we possess our souls. We stand on a rock. A rock is long-suffering, endures all weather. Eventually, it becomes even as strong as marble. It's all about long-suffering, and that is our strength. So the next line here is disease-covered Puget Sound. Believe it or not, this is absolutely biblical. Probably the topic we would use, the word we would use, the biblical terminology we would be using is wormwood. That would probably fall into this category. We've already established that Seattle is in end time prophecy. You will find this in the playlist linked below. So this isn't just a play on words, Kurt using Seattle as imagery of the song, all that kind of stuff. Seattle is in end time prophecy, and it seems like God's going to use Seattle for the millennial reign. So disease-covered Puget Sound is actually likely what would be called in our Bibles as wormwood. So when we do a biblical topic search of wormwood, we could easily see this. Here we are in Jeremiah 9:15. Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will feed them, even this people, with wormwood and give them water and gall to drink. Most famously, we likely see this in the book of Revelation. And the name of that star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood. And many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Another way we could look at this is going back to the plagues of Egypt. When Moses cursed the Nile River with blood. This is something we could very likely see in the Great Tribulation. Again, in the end times. So this could indefinitely be a way to perceive a disease-covered Puget Sound.
Our favorite patient. Display of patience, disease got a Puget Sound.
Okay guys, so there we have it. That is the biblical understanding of our favorite patient, a display of patience, disease covered Puget Sound. Again, I would like to thank you for tuning in. Of course, I prayerfully ask that you please consult the Holy Spirit to lead you into all truth. Thanks again. God bless you.